Well, in making it, Chris, Bob and I, we tried to capture what for us was the magic of fishing. And they made a wonderful pair. They worked really hard to do it. And we spent 4.5 years getting the 6 1/2s made. And we took that long because we felt it was important to have the magic of those moments that we know, like the mist rising up by the lilies and the red quill float and the bubbles of the tench and so on. That's the magic of angling, and to get those moments it takes time. So why is it thought to be, can't remember the question, why is it thought to be something special? Well, because we took a lot of trouble to make it special. And I think only by making it as magical as possible do we ever stand a chance of getting fishing on television again. If you don't invest the effort in doing it, then you're not going to get commissions for future films. But it did go down tremendously well. The response has been fantastic. For instance, I got a card after the first show from somebody. He says, just 3 lines. He says, "I don't go fishing. I don't even like fishing, but I'm hooked." I mean, it was a perfect response. Another guy we had came here. He had a brain tumour and he was in hospital. And he was allowed to watch one programme a day because it calmed him. And he came here and he was in tears, and he nearly had us in tears, because he reckoned by making that series and by him watching one every day, it helped cure him and kept him alive, basically. So that's pretty magical. I think other elements of the film, I thought the music was wonderful by Jenny Musket. I loved the music. Chris thought it was a bit sweet, but I thought it was absolutely perfect, hit the spot. And it still makes my hair stand on end occasionally. I haven't seen it for ages, but when I do, I think, this is really nice. You know, the imagery, the wildlife, the guys creeping about in the bushes, and the music just capturing the essence of spring or summer or autumn, winter, whatever it was. I loved making it. It was tremendous. By the end, the two lads had had enough, but I was determined to make it as good as possible. And what was remarkable in those days, I was completely left alone to do it in the way I was. They never looked at anything, they never changed anything. That wouldn't happen nowadays. You'd have a layer of executives all saying, "Oh no, you don't want to do this, you want to do that." Whereas the commissioning editor at the BBC gave me the money. He didn't give me it all by any means. Took me about 12 years to get the money back from making that series. But he gave me the money. I'd told him what I was going to try and achieve, and he left me completely alone. I delivered the programmes that went out. Ended up with 6.3 million audience, I think, by the final programme. It was a tremendous success, which was very heartening. And it's still selling even now. Just a trickle, but a little bit of money for bread flake, for mullet or roach. So. I know, and many of us do, that fishing is absolutely wonderful, but I don't think it's perceived as being of any interest by townies, and they're the ones who make the decisions about what programmes to be commissioned. I think if we were to get mad celebrities doing the fishing, then there would be a chance, but then most anglers wouldn't want to see some mad celebrity who didn't know anything about fishing actually on the television. So I have no interest in making films on fishing using a celebrity, because it's a nonsense. Why not? You wouldn't have somebody pretending to be Andy Murray playing tennis when they can't play tennis. You watch Andy Murray playing tennis, and you know, I would rather watch Chris Yates or Steve Ringer or whatever actually fishing, because they know what they're doing, and then you're learning something by the experience and probably entertained by watching it as well. So I think unless we use celebrities, then I think we're unlikely ever to get fishing on terrestrial television again, which is pretty sad, I think. I'm not happy about the notorious for a start. I don't know who's been telling you stories, but I certainly wouldn't apologise, because I think we owe it to everybody to try and do as well as we can in any walk of life we are, and making fishing films is just the same. I work myself really hard, but I'm certainly not a perfectionist. And to try to be a perfectionist in angling or wildlife would be pretty much impossible. But I do try really hard. Yeah, I'll do anything to try and achieve a better result. So absolutely no apologies. As far as people I've worked with, Chris and Bob, you know, they did find it trying in the end because it has gone on so long, and they worked tremendously hard and did a great job. And Martin in Catching the Impossible was brilliant. But it is difficult making a film that's good enough to survive on television and actually get an audience. If it bombs, if it fails, then you've only got yourself to blame if you haven't actually tried as hard as you can. And you can't sleep at night if you've actually sort of thought, oh, that'll do. It's not good enough. You owe it to your audience to actually try and do it as well as possible. So absolutely no apologies whatsoever. Well, the first part of the question is easy. It undoubtedly be Martin Bowler. He was absolutely wonderful on Catching the Impossible. Lovely bloke, incredibly intelligent, very quick to respond to requests or instructions, maybe even. And of course, incredibly well prepared. He never forgot continuity, and he was always on the ball. A total professional, absolutely on time. As professional, in fact, if not more so, than Sir David Attenborough, who I've worked with a lot. He was that good. So it was easy working with him because he's always on the ball, always had the preparation. So when we got to the location, we'd be on a roll. And of course, he's an absolutely brilliant angler, so he kept on delivering these impossible fish. I mean, the impossible thing was a gag. But actually now, if you asked him, he'd say, well, a lot of the fish we caught would be impossible because the environment's declined and fishing's declined, rivers have declined so much since we made the series, which is pretty tragic because it wasn't very long ago. So it would be Martin Bowler. I love filming with Chris Yates and so on, but if I had to make a series, it would be Martin, because he's a lovely bloke, really generous guy, very honest. Never lets anybody down who he helps. He wouldn't give sites away that we were privileged enough to visit, although we did use a lot of day ticket waters. So I couldn't say, I couldn't be too complimentary for what Martin achieves. And I'm going salmon fishing with him next week, so on the Wye. But he's a lovely bloke. As far as where to fish, that's a difficult one. There's so many lovely rivers and lakes. It would be a river, but the rivers are pretty difficult now. So maybe where he's making a film now, maybe Milton Abbas Lake. It's wonderfully clear. We did quite a lot of the underwater filming because it's a crystal clear chalk stream fed lake. We did quite a lot of the underwater stuff for Catching the Impossible there. Wayne Little, who runs the fishery, owns the fishery, he was very kind. Let us go. So that might be at least one of the locations. Peter Drennan's lake in Oxfordshire. Lovely, absolute classic tench water with lilies and the floats. Passion for Angling, actually, one of the first sequences was done there. Yeah. I've been passionate about angling since I was a boy. So when I was at film college learning how to, I was doing a degree course in filmmaking, we had to do a project. So I thought, I'll do a project about fishing. So I went up to the Norfolk Broads and went out pike fishing with Dennis Pye. And we made a film. We had a stuffed fish in the college, which was a 26-pound pike. So I said to Dennis, can we go out in the Norfolk Broads and catch a 26-pound pike? And blow me, he did it. On the day I went up there, we got a 26-pound pike. And you get lots of people sceptical about Dennis being more sketchy, and, you know, they weren't the weight he was. He was a brilliant angler. People wouldn't know how intuitive he was in the Norfolk Broads. So he delivered, so I made this little film about Dennis Pye catching this giant pike. So that was the first film. And then Passion for Angling came about because I was going to make a series of three films about Bhutan. which is up in the Himalayas, as people maybe know, is legendary place, which is absolutely wonderful for wildlife. I'd been on a recce with the World Wildlife Fund and met the king and so on, got the permissions. And then at the last minute, they had a military coup, so I couldn't go. So I sat in the corner of the office, thought, blimey, what am I going to do? You know, suddenly this huge window opened up. I thought, I'll make a fishing film. So, and that's how Passion for Angling was born. But before that, when I left film college, I'd been out with Richard Walker, and I was going to, and he was one of my childhood heroes, as he was for many people, I was actually going to make a series with Richard, and I went out with him and Pete Thomas on Graffon. We discussed how we were going to lay out the series, 6 half-hours we were going to make. And sadly, then I got snatched by the BBC, and I was working on Life on Earth. That was my first job. So I never did get to do the series with Richard Walker. But this window opened up for Passion for Angling, so I got in touch with Chris, who I knew well, and Bob, and said, let's go and make a film. Initially, we were going to make 1 half-hour at Redmar. We thought we'd go to Redmar, opening the season. But we had to get the fishing first, so they went to the auction for the first week. It's usually auctioned by the Carp Society. And Chris said, when they come back from the auction, said, do you want the good news or the bad news first? I said, I'll have the good news first. Well, we got the week. And the bad news? It cost us £2,000 for the week's fishing. Anyway, we went there. And it was absolutely magical. We had weather like this. Absolutely perfect. The same every day. The fish did the same thing. The continuity, the fish would go up to the shallows during the day and then drop down into deep water at night. So we knew exactly where the fish would be. And instead of catching one or two fish, we caught 4 20-pounders. You know, it was extraordinary. So it had to be a 1 hour. So I said to the lads, well, we can't sell a single 1 hour. I said, it'll have to be a series. So how about it? And it had been so easy. We'd caught 4 20-pound carp. And the previous 2 years, no one had caught any carp at all in the opening week of the season. And even I'd caught some carp from Redmar with a pin and a little bit of worm down the edge. So anyway, they were up for it because it seemed very easy. We had 10 days and we'd made a complete 50-minute film. Anyway, after that, it wasn't 4.5 years later we actually finished it. So they wished they hadn't said yes. So that's sort of how I got into it. And of course, I had more wildlife films, so the Passion for Angling took a long time because it wasn't full-time. I was having to go off and earn the money. Most of it I had to pay myself, for myself. The BBC gave us some money, but only half the budget. So I had to raise money by going and making wildlife films. As far as the question, what am I most proud of? I don't know, I made lots of over 60 wildlife films. But two stand out, I guess. One was a tiger film in India, which we told a story about a female tiger. And we won a BAFTA for photography for that. And I've won two others as well. But another film that was my favourite film was about mountain lions, pumas in Patagonia. And I walked around. It took me 4.5 months to habituate this particular female puma. And then I could walk around the mountain. She'd go to sleep 20 feet from me. And she came up and sniffed my head one night when I was laid down trying to get some sleep in the middle of the night. I never did that again. It terrified me. And that was just such a magical experience, to be able to walk around, to be trusted by this wild puma. And she'd talk to me even when I came back from Christmas. I'd come home here to see the children, go back out there, and she'd walk out the cave and come on, wow. Just like a pussycat at home. Magic. Almost brings tears to my eyes just to mention it. So I guess in terms of field craft and the ability to be sensitive to an animal, that would probably take the biscuit. I guess one would be with Chris. We were doing a film about this lovely lake up in Wiltshire. And we had no ambition to catch anything particularly special there. But we wanted a few events, and we caught some carp, and we're stalking and so on with Chris, and tiny little quill floats and all these old gear and everything. And it was charming, but it was just an escape from reality, if you like. And Chris is wonderful to work with, an intuitive angler. So we caught quite a lot of carp and tench and so on. But in the end, on a hot day like this, the carp moved up into the shallows as they did at Redmar. So we crept up really carefully on hands and knees through the vegetation. And there were the carp in front of us. And he flicked out a bit of sweet corn, just as he did when he caught the record carp, the 51 pounder from Redmar. And he'd never caught a 20 pound carp in fishing that lake for about 30 years. And I was rolling when the line twitched and the line slid out. And he caught a 26 and a half pounder, I think it was, right there. His first ever 20 pounder. A pint of beer has never tasted so good ever. That would have been with Chris again. We were stalking carp at Linear Fisheries. There's a little sequence there. For catching the impossible. And there were some lovely big ghosties drifting around 20 odd pounds, and we were going, oh no, so just. And they were coming so close and the line was twitching and we couldn't get. In the end, he hooked a carp. It wasn't very big, but it was fighting quite hard, and I was there with a handheld camera trying to get it, and I needed to slightly get a better angle on him so I could see his expression with his centre pin and everything else. So I came round and round and round, and then suddenly my feet went away from me. And I was in the lake with the carp. But I had the presence of mind to hold the camera up. So there's a wobbly bit for a minute. And Chris had the rod in one hand. He had the camera in the other hand, filming me climbing out the lake laughing. And then I took the camera from him and then we landed the carp. So that was quite entertaining, really. And we used the whole sequence in Catching the Impossible as well. I'm dedicated now, absolutely passionate about trying to raise the profile of fish. Not enough wildlife organisations even recognise the fact that fish exist, let alone considering the need for their conservation. So I'm working really hard on trying to raise the profile of fish locally. Initially, I've made a film about the little chalk stream in Dorset, not far from home here, the River Allen, for Dorset Wildlife Trust, and that's showing on the website and on in a cafe, and I use it for lecturing purposes for fundraising. So I'm going around with the Dorset Wildlife Trust trying to promote that river, but also trying to promote fish. And at the moment I'm doing an underwater fish story for the Dorset Wildlife Trust and for use on their website, so that'll be viewable by many people around the world, and I'll also put it on my blog when I've finished it. But the weather's too good for filming at the moment. I'm out fishing, mullet fishing.